Mark 2:23. And Jesus was walking through some cornfields on the Sabbath. As his disciples walked along with him, they began to pick the ears of corn. So the Pharisees said to Jesus, "Look, it's against our law for your disciples to do that on the Sabbath." But Jesus answered, "Have you never read what David did that time when he needed something to eat? He and his men were hungry, so they went into the house of God and ate the bread offered to God. This happened when Abiathar was the high priest. According to our law, only the priests may eat this bread, but David ate it and even gave it to his men." And Jesus concluded, "The Sabbath was made for the good of man. Man was not made for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath." Then Jesus went back to the synagogue where there was a man with a paralyzed hand. Some people were there who wanted to accuse Jesus of doing wrong. So they watched him closely to see whether he would heal the man on the Sabbath. Jesus said to the man, "Come up here to the front." And then he asked the people, "What does our law allow us to do on the Sabbath? To help or to harm? To save a man's life or to destroy it?" But they did not say a thing. And Jesus was angry as he looked round at them, but at the same time he felt sorry for them, because they were so stubborn and wrong. Then he said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." He stretched it out and it became well again. So the Pharisees left the synagogue and met at once with some members of Herod's party, and they made plans to kill Jesus. I wanted just to share a few thoughts out of that passage with you this morning, which is apposite for today, I think, as to whether we are the sort of people who are living lives for whom the law tells you all the things you can't do, or whether the law tells you all the things you can do, and how our sort of tendency to be tied down with all the things we can't do very often lies with our history and our experience of things that have gone wrong previously, and how God calls us to not just be hemmed in but released to new things. This story here is a continuing of the stories we've been reading about Jesus sort of giving people a completely new view of what the kingdom of God is going to be like. But here he comes across, we have these two little pictures together all about the Sabbath. And in both of them, they come along and they say, "Oh, you can't do that on the Sabbath." On the one hand, they're walking through the cornfields and Jesus' disciples are doing the very first thing towards making bread. It's not very far into making bread, but anyway, it's a bit into making bread. So that's work on the Sabbath. Sucking of teeth, you can't do that. And then he comes into the synagogue. There's a man with a withered hand. Well, sort of doing medical procedures, that's work. You can't do that on the Sabbath. And he does both. Now, the law of the Sabbath had come from God, you know, saying, "I want you to honor the Sabbath, the seventh day, you're not going to do any work." And in Jewish history, they'd often disobeyed God's laws and had notably been punished for disobeying one law or another of all sorts. And so as they'd gone on, the authorities had thought, "We mustn't disobey any of God's laws." So they produced all sorts of regulations to make sure you didn't disobey God's laws. So at the end of the day, with this, whether it was time or money or food or all sorts of things, but in this case with the Sabbath, there were 57 varieties of things you couldn't do on the Sabbath. In fact, you couldn't do anything on the Sabbath, really. But they were hemmed in by all these laws. But they'd all come for the right reason, to keep the Sabbath, to keep it holy. And so they got to this. And the constraint was, you can't do this, you can't do that, you can't do that. And before we think that they're very antiquated, I think that in many ways our society is a society now born of what you can't do. Virtually all of our laws and our regulations tell you what you can't do. I might have told you this before, but years ago when we were in London, remember going to the municipal swimming pool in Dartford, which was a proper swimming pool, you know, rectangular for swimming up and down in. And there was a big sign on the wall, and I can't remember all that it said, but it told you all the things you couldn't do. No running, no diving, no water bombing, and no kissing. Now, I mean, you know, you can see where that comes from, but it told you all, it didn't say, have a nice swim. It told you all the things you can't do. Just as it's very rare to find a municipal sign that says, please park here. It tells you everywhere you can't park. Don't park here, don't park there, don't park there, don't park there. Pay here, but don't park anywhere. And so all our regulations, our planning regulations, you can't build that there. And you certainly can't build that there. We know about regulations for conservation. Can't move that, can't change that. Those pews are set in stone. And so it goes on, and some of these things are important, and some of them are not. They tell us, for instance, you know, with health and safety, can't have one of those. They tell us now you can't sit in the front row of the gallery. No, you can't do that. Somebody might fall over the outside. You can't do that, you see. Can't do that. Can't sit there. Can't sit there. And health and food hygiene. Oh, you're not cooking there, are you? No, we're not, you see. Can't do that. And so it goes on. But I'm not saying these are not bad things, but they just to define what we do. It's what you can't do, isn't it? And so on. And you can't talk to people like that. And you can't discriminate in any way about that person or that, but you can't say that. That could be right, but you still, it's not saying what you do say, it tells you what you don't say. And the criminal law tells you how you can't behave to people. You can't kill them, you can't beat them, and you can't. It doesn't tell you what you could do to them. It's always negative. It's always tying you in all the time. And just like it was with the Jews, where they remembered that they'd been punished and they wanted to take things seriously, and that's how they got into this, in many ways it's our history which brings us to this kind of thing. It's our history, you know, the business that you can't cross the railway down by Long Rock. You can't do it because sadly somebody was knocked down and killed. It's the history that means that we go into safety first. I imagine somebody somewhere in the universe fell off one of these balconies. So you can't sit there anymore. There's visions of mayhem and everybody parking everywhere in gridlock, so you can't park there. Somebody got food poisoning doing that, so you can't cook like that. And somebody built that, I was going to say the tax office in the middle of Penzance. So you can't have that anymore, can we? Blow it up. But anyway. But it comes out of the past. And it's internationally as well, isn't it? Internationally, we have all sorts of regulations about, you know, what you cannot do with the United Nations and the European Court of Human Rights and the War Crimes Tribunals and so on and so forth, and the Geneva Conventions, telling you all sorts of ways that nations can and cannot behave, but virtually all of them tell them what they can't do. You can't do that, you can't do that. You can't evade people, you can't go in, you can't just make war, you can't do this, you can't do that. And again, that comes out of looking back at the catastrophe of war and saying, this should not happen again. We don't want that again. And so we say, no, you can't invade somebody just like that, like we used to. That's a disaster. You can't behave inhumanely in a war. So you have the Geneva Conventions. You can't kill civilians. You can't do this. You can't do that. You can't do that. You can't be genocidal, so we have crimes against humanity. What we have learned from the past, we have tried to put in a series of structures which are good, but again, virtually always define what it is prohibited to do. And I think in our own private lives even, we are often tied in to the things you can't do and you can't say. If I were you, I wouldn't say that. If you do that, you'll be in deep trouble. Don't let's go there. Have you ever heard anybody in a conversation who said, let's go there? They don't. They always say, don't let's go there. You know? Because we know that sometime it went pear-shaped before. Sometime there was a family row. Somebody burst into tears and rushed out. Somebody got into a terrible... And because of how it was, thus I am safety first. Then I don't do that. Don't say that. Oh, don't say that. What have you do? But also in a deeper sense, I'm thinking, no, I don't want to do that. I better not do that. That's a bit risky. I read about somebody who did that before, and no. And the history makes us like that. And one of the places I run on the moors is used to be some kind of bridle way. It's a public right of way, but now it's two big brambly hedges with about this much between them. And I just sort of, it's almost as though the hedges have grudgingly given you a bit of a gap between the two of them, and I kind of run up the middle, brushing both hedge. Hey, life is so much like that with law, isn't it? You can't do that, you can't do that, but the rest is free for you to do what you like in. And behind it all is somehow lurking in our subconscious the commandments that tell us, well, the state says you can't do that, and society says you can't do that, and tradition says you can't do it, and the family says you can't do that, and your subconscious history tells you you can't do that, and behind it all, God tells you you can't do it either. In fact, a lot of people have put off Christianity because they think they've got enough laws, and if they come here, God will introduce some more. Some more things I can't do, which I didn't know I couldn't do. Squeezing in between the law. Lord, I don't want to offend you like that. I don't want to offend you like that. This is what the Jews were like, and this is what we are. And Jesus walks into the middle of this, and he does not say, as some people think he said, and some people then wanted him to say, blow that, we don't do law, we just do grace. He doesn't say that. He doesn't abolish the law. He says the Sabbath was made with man and not man for the Sabbath. He's basically taking it back to the roots of it. Honor the Sabbath and keep it holy is the command. This law was to liberate people from 7 day a week working. This law was to give people freedom and space to be restored and to be blessed and have a day off and have some recreation and above all to worship, not to starve and not to be ill, but to be put right and restored and made good. And Jesus says, this is how it's supposed to be. This is what the law's about. It's about what you should be doing and what you can be doing. Yeah, if you go too far, then you will bump up against what you can't do. But it's about what you can do, fundamentally. And he goes back into history and says, look at the history of it. And he has this obscure example from David in the middle of a civil war, or at least a guerrilla war, where David goes into this holy shrine and there is the showbread, which is very holy bread on the high altar, a bit like our communion bread, only a lot more holy than that. And you couldn't touch it and you couldn't eat it, and it was there in the Holy of Holies, and only the priest could eat it later on and all that sort of thing. And David said, I and my men and my band of men, we are starving, we need to eat. So the priest gives him the food, and he eats the whole lot. And he breaks every rule in the book. It's holy bread. As it was put out on the altar, it was probably the Sabbath. As it was in a holy place, he shouldn't have been there anyway. And he wasn't a priest. It's all bad. It's all wrong. But he eats and he lives. Because actually God is there to bless him and feed him, not to starve him. I am the bread of life, says Jesus. Feed on me. And Jesus says, the law of the Sabbath is to do good and to bless, not just to tie down and restrict. Yes, it is holy, but the holiness comes to feed you, not to starve you. And so in lots of other things where Jesus says, this, yes, the law is true, but you've lost the point. It's now just become a constraint rather than a possibility. Business about an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, you know. It was meant, whatever we think it was meant, it was meant in the Old Testament to say, you must not take more than one eye for one eye. Because in the times it was given, if you lost an eye, the opposition came round with their entire tribe and destroyed you. The law said you can't take more than an eye for an eye and more than a tooth for a tooth. So that was the law. You can't do it. You can't kill them, even if you feel like killing them. Jesus says, let's move on from there, shall we? The point is, how can you minimize your retribution? He said, in fact, forgive them. Do good to those who hurt you. Love your enemies. That's what it's really about. It's not you can only have one eye. It is that you want to be blessing them. Bless those who curse you. That is what you want to do. Not don't do this and don't do that. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your strength, with all your mind. And the rest of it will fill in. Because as soon as you drop off the end of love, you can't do that. But love is a great thing. Is there any law against this? No, it's not, he says. What about the laws against impurity? We can't touch lepers and women and Gentiles and all sort of thing, you know. And Jesus heals lepers and talks to women and goes to tax collectors' gatherings and all this sort of thing. Because the holiness is not to be protected by not touching anything. It's be developed. Holiness is spread through all the earth by healing people and including people and blessing people and forgiving people and bringing them into the kingdom. We do things and it expands rather than we don't do that. And for us today, the gospel is love the Lord your God, love your neighbor as you love yourself. That is the great commandment. That is the great law. Am I prepared under Christ to live as a man or a woman who says, yes, we can, rather than no, we can't? This is not a libertarian thing. You will bump up against stuff. But it is something which is liberating because it gives us new possibilities, new hopes, new joys. And Jesus says to me, my law is that you should do this. You should go for this. Look again at our history where our traditions and our habits and our regulations are stripped out, very often by crises. It's strange that today's date is 9/11, isn't it? Because the Americans do 9/11 the other way around. You think of all the regulations that occurred for safety and health in the Trade Center. All those escalators that you couldn't run on, and all those lifts that you couldn't go in, and all those different secure areas within them, you know, board meeting rooms and engineers' gantries, and those huge buildings, if you'd gone into them in peacetime, in normal time, there would have been so many things you couldn't do for health and safety reasons. And yet, as they were blowing up and burning, everybody did everything. Everybody went through doors which said no admittance. Everybody climbed down things where it said this is a terribly dangerous place to be. Because the big thing was there to be saved, not to be safe. And you could see that the goodness and the sacrifice and the heroics there emerging. And people who sacrifice themselves for others, no greater love as a man. No, you can't do that. Yes, this needs to be done. That's very dangerous. That's why we're doing it. And that guy, what was he called? I think Alan Hemmings, wasn't it? He didn't do health and safety. He didn't do Foreign Office recommendations. He didn't do, we don't like people who don't like us. He goes there and he gets beheaded. It is in war time and it's in terrible situations and in crisis like David was having that all the other stuff is stripped out, all those negative bits are stripped out, and the real center of God's law is uncovered, if you like. The armies need lots of regulations. You've got to, with lots of aggressive young men with arms, you need lots of regulations. But it is in wartime and in the real thing, again and again and again, you read that was set aside, or that didn't work, or everybody got together and did it when they shouldn't have been doing it. But actually, that's where heroics came. That's where sacrifice came. That's where people were bonded together. I know you don't want to sort of sentimentalize the Blitz, but a lot of regulations were put to one side and a lot of distinctions were put to one side, a lot of prejudice. And the real thought of coming out and doing good and caring for my neighbor did come out more and more. And people were released, even in the First World War. Before the First World War, there were huge regulations within society for what women couldn't do. Now, the Bible is very clear about the distinction between male and female, but it's not interested in a post-Victorian view of what women can and cannot do. But because of the war, women came and did all the things they'd ever done before and worked in factories and made things and did things and ran things and drove things and, wow, we could do this, yeah. But that's God's destiny for us to expand, not to be tied in. It's in extremis that very often that comes out. You find that in your own family. I remember when the crisis was, we all pulled together, and you would never have believed it of so-and-so, what it brought out of them. In the end, Jesus says to the man of the withered hand, stretch it out. We, as individuals, as a society, as nations, are often shriveled. It's there, but it don't work. I'm telling you all the time that I'm disabled and I can't do this, I can't do that, I can't do that, for any number of reasons. And we say, well, we can't help for any other number of reasons. Then our society still says that, because we can't help you because of this and because of that and because of that. Our country says, we can't help you because it's not in our national interest. We're still saying that. Jesus says, stretch it out. Because the law is not just you can do this, not the way that Obama said, yes, we can, and then prove that you can't. No, God says, yes, we can, because I can make you do it. He says, that withered hand, stretch it out. God changes that. It's not just that we can be people who expand into the positive, but Jesus in his spirit gives us the power to do that. It's not just the permission, but it's the ability. Yes, we can. Love one another. Love God. Do good. Heal. This is the Sabbath. That's what it's for. Let's do it. And so really what God is saying to us is, this is not just squeezing between two hedges. What God has in mind for you in your lives is like a big field. Yes, there are hedges, but it's not about the hedges. It's about the field. See what the Lord has done. See that what life in all its fullness it could be. And if you bump up against the edges, it's still there. The law is there. But it's not about that. It is that you expand and grow. We need that in our society. We need that in our world. And we need that in our lives. Band just going to come and play for us. About God's faithfulness and strength, and we're just going to pray through this a moment. I want you to feel that out of the security of God, you can say, yes, I can. It's like a child, a small child with a big parent. The child is much braver when the parent's there. Oh, I could do this because dad's here or mum's here. You know, you see them in the playground. They look around at the play park. Look around. I'm here. Oh, I can do it then. Can I go up on the slide? Yes, you can. I'm here. Out of the security of God. Yes, we can, and he helps us in his spirit. Faithful one, so unchanging. Let's stand and sing this together.